all you generous people who wandered in here and laid out your $3. This is the College of Complexes.
No.
Yeah. And that's, we're about to commence to begin. We are happy to have David Ramsay Steele with us tonight, who will be speaking to us about, what's his name, Graeber? David Graeber? And he seems to have been influential in the Occupy Wall Street movement and other occupations. But you will hear details about that from our speaker. Our speaker, David Ramsay.
Couldn't we have some more ado?
Can you hear me?
I do. Yes.
Fellow members of the human species, and anybody else who may be paying attention, I'm going to talk about, let's say a little bit about David Graeber. I'm not talking about the entire Occupy Wall Street movement and its ideology. Many people would say that David Graeber is the leading guru or theoretician of the Occupy movement, but most people in the Occupy movement would be very indignant and would repudiate that because they don't have any leaders, they don't have any formal structure, they don't have any gurus, so I'm not going to say it. But he is an influential proponent of the Occupy movement. He is also a professor of cultural anthropology. Anthropology is the study of humankind. Physical anthropology is going around measuring people's skulls and things like that. Cultural anthropology or social anthropology is analyzing the customs of people in different cultures. So that's what he does for a living. He's an American, but he teaches in London. As a cultural anthropologist, and his reputation as a scholar in the field of anthropology is fairly high. Now, my political views are such that you might expect me to think David Graeber as the incarnation of evil and my polar opposite, and in some ways he is. But I do like him as a writer. And the main reason for that is that he's very unpretentious, he's straightforward, he's plain spoken, which is remarkable for anybody on the left, but it's also remarkable for any social scientist at this time in history. So the fact that he's both a leftist activist and a social scientist, and that he speaks plainly, writes very clearly and unpretentiously with no mystifying tricks, this is in itself a remarkable thing, and I greatly admire him for it. I also agree with him on some specific points. I'm just like him, opposed to the bailouts that occurred in 2009 of big financial concerns that had made a mess of things. I'm also opposed to the United States constantly bombing people all around the world. Military involvement in other countries that is no business of the United States. So I do have some points of agreement with him. But I'm a free market person, and he's very much not a free market person. He calls himself an anarchist. He's an anarchist loosely in the tradition of Mikhail Bakunin, that's to say, an anarcho-communist. Now, what I'm going to say about him, it falls into two categories. First of all, I'm going to talk about his best-selling book, the book that most people have read of his, which is called Debt, The First 5,000 Years. And then after that, I'm going to talk about his ideas on the revolution. So, his book, Debt, The First 5,000 Years, or as some people affectionately say, Debt, The First 500 Pages, is a remarkable book. I certainly recommend it. It's well worth reading. It's entertaining. It's full of fascinating anecdotes and it's well documented. It's a scholarly book, but it's also a pamphlet. I would say as a scholarly book it's rather poor, for reasons that I will explain. And as a pamphlet it's quite good. It's one of the great pamphlets. The Communist Manifesto, 1848, was a great pamphlet, even though I strongly disagree with most of what it says. And Debt, the First 5,000 Years, is a great pamphlet, even though I strongly disagree with most of what it says. So, what does he say in this book? Well, he begins by taking, and this occupies a great deal of the book, he begins by taking what he says is the established economic view, economist's view of money, debt, and financial matters, and he proceeds to knock it down, he proceeds to refute it. Now what does he say is the conventional view of economics, or of monetary economics? According to Graeber, the conventional view about the origin of money is that there was a time when people used to barter. There was something called a barter economy where people used to swap things, they used to exchange things. And this was useful to them because they could get what they want if somebody else had it and was prepared to swap it for something they had. But it could be inconvenient. And then someone invented money, and this made the whole thing a whole lot easier, because it meant that if you had money, you could buy anything. So you didn't have to find someone who had exactly what you wanted and wanted exactly what you had. Instead, you just had to find someone who would accept money, and that would be anybody. So you would sell whatever you had to sell, and then you'd use the money that you got from that sale to go and buy what you wanted, and that's a lot more efficient. Remember, this is Graeber's account of what the conventional view is. Now, Graeber also says that the conventional view is that all the early transactions, all the early trades, were spot transactions. Spot transaction is where the two things change hands at the same time. So I hand over my money, you give me what I'm buying at the same time. Now a credit transaction might be, I hand you my money and then time passes and later you deliver me what I've paid for. So this is another of Graeber's pictures of the conventional view. Now, it's also part of the conventional view that money evolved naturally with people trading, and then subsequently the government came along and started to regulate it. Now, Graeber rejects all this, and a lot of the book is taken up with examples, historical examples he has of proving that this is wrong. The first thing he says is, there is no such thing as a barter economy. No one has ever observed a barter economy. No one's ever seen a barter economy working. And remember that David Graeber is a cultural anthropologist. Cultural anthropologists are experts on what is known about different cultures. So I should say something about anthropology for those who may not know this. That when European peoples and European descended peoples were exploring the world, they came across non-European peoples with strange customs, as it seemed to them. And they, for various motives, started analyzing and observing and recording what they saw about these exotic cultures. And eventually this evolved into a profession, an academic profession, that people would go from London or New York or Paris or Berlin, and they go and live with what in those days we were allowed to call a primitive tribe. We're not allowed to call them that anymore. They go and live with a primitive tribe for a couple of years, and they spend every day closely observing everything that went on in this primitive tribe. They come back home and they write up a report on the beliefs, the customs, the kinship systems, the financial systems, if any, the government system, if any, the ways of settling disputes, the religious beliefs, everything about this primitive tribe, they would write up. This is the sort of paradigm of cultural anthropology. And when you just write it up and make an account, an accurate account of what this tribal culture believes and how they live their lives, that's called ethnography. And that's the main part of cultural anthropology. You then go on to theorize about this, draw conclusions, make comparisons between different cultures. This is the broader discipline of cultural anthropology. And a huge amount of material has been amassed by cultural anthropologists. And some of the terminology that's been popularized by cultural anthropologists has passed into everyday speech. Most of us have heard of the term taboo, for example. Well, that comes from cultural anthropology, that they found one tribe that used this word taboo for things that were prohibited. Another is the expression rite of passage, rite de passage in French, which it comes from cultural anthropologists who noticed that in every culture, or almost every culture, there were rituals marking the transition from one stage of life to another. For instance, from childhood to adulthood, every culture would have a ritual to mark this transition, and that was called a rite of passage. So, what do you find if you're a cultural anthropologist and you read all these thousands of accounts of different cultures and the way they live? One thing you never find is a barter economy. You just don't find it. Now, here I think maybe I should explain something which is not in dispute between me and David Graeber, but is something that you maybe ought to know as a background to this discussion. And that is that different things in human history have been used as money. Seashells, gold and silver, of course, tobacco, precious stones, all kinds of things have been used as money. And when you find people exchanging things that are not coins or bills, it doesn't mean they're bartering. If you look closely, it could mean that they're using a different form of money. So if you see some Polynesian islander exchanging coconuts for seashells, you mustn't assume that this is barter, because it could be that the seashells are money in that culture. So that's not in dispute. That's a common assumption of everybody who's thought about this. Now, what Graeber says is that we never see a case of a barter economy. We never see a case of a repeated, systematic exchange of goods where there is no single good that has been singled out as money. What we see, in fact, are two things. Within a culture, within a tribe, or within a village, we find that people exchange things in a way that is heavily governed by their family relationships and their customer relationships. And isn't really like market transactions as we understand them. And then where we do see exchange, it's exchange between different groups that meet and make an affair of it, and they're treated to some extent like enemies. It's a dangerous business, and it's guided by certain rules that emerge traditionally. But what we don't find is anywhere we look is a barter economy. Now, so basically what he's saying is the origin of trade is between communities and not between individuals within a community. He also argues that he's in favor of what's called the state theory of money. He believes that governments originated money. So that at some time, and he thinks in Sumer, the Sumerian civilization, which existed in what is now Iraq, 6,000 or 7,000 years ago, He thinks that in Sumer, the government invented money, and the first money was not something that emerged in the exchange of goods. It was something the government used to enable people to pay taxes and force them to pay their taxes. So that's his theory. Now, I think that part of what Graeber says about all this is perfectly correct. However, I think he misunderstands what economists have generally said about this. It so happens that in my first book, which was published in 1992, called From Marx to Mises, I point out in passing that there is no such thing as a barter economy. And basically, what's going on here is that economists, in order to explain the advantages of money, suppose hypothetically that there was a barter economy in the distant past, and that people got beyond this by inventing money. But this is just an abstract way of explaining something. It doesn't mean they actually think there was a stage in human history where people regularly bartered things instead of using money. I think if you look at Graeber's account, you find various problems with it. First of all, I think one of the first questions that would occur to you is, if the state is announcing, is laying down what is money, how does the state know when it first does this how much everything should be priced at? This is a bit of a puzzle. It's difficult to see how the state could invent money out of the blue. And then I think that Graeber misrepresents what economists have said when he suggests that they think that there were only spot transactions and that credit transactions came later. I don't think economists have ever argued this. I think everybody understands, and economists have written about the origin of money, understand that credit started at a very early stage. Now, there are two things about Graeber's account of the origin of money and the development of money, which to me are very surprising and very striking. There are two things he doesn't talk about. He doesn't talk about what happened before Sumer, before this civilization of city-states arose in Iraq, say 7,000 years ago. And he doesn't talk about, he talks about what goes on inside a village, and he talks about what happens when the representative of a culture meet the representatives of another culture. But he doesn't talk about the phenomenon of traveling merchants. Well, he does mention them in passing, but he doesn't relate it to this issue. But what we find, I think, if we look at human history and prehistory, is that people who travel to trade, traveling merchants and traveling peddlers, are an important feature. If we start with something that everybody's heard of, the Silk Road. You know, people in ancient Rome, the rich people in ancient Rome, often wore silk. They wore silk togas, silk robes. Now that silk was grown in China. The Romans didn't go to China to get it. As far as we know, no Roman ever went to China, or even halfway to China. What happened was that traveling merchants, traveling in big caravanserai for their mutual protection, left China and went west across the Gobi Desert, and also in ships, but there was a big land route, carrying silk. And they sold this silk at various stages. And sometimes there would be other merchants who would take it over from that point. So there was a route that went for thousands of miles, a couple of thousand miles anyway, which was divided into segments. And where the segments met, we call them entrepôts, where traders get together. And one reason to have an entrepôt might be that the terrain changes so that a different method of transport is required. So you might use a camel at one stage, but then you might use a wheeled vehicle, or you might go into portage, that is carrying boats from one waterway to the next, and so on. So silk found its way to Rome, and ancient Romans in the empire wore silk. Now, before the Romans, there were Greeks, there were Phoenicians, there were Egyptians, and all of these civilizations, all of these cultures, were big traders. The Mediterranean was full of trading ships, and it was actually full of pirates who made a living preying on the merchants who were carrying these goods for trade. So already we're seeing a history of financial transactions, commercial transactions, carried on by specialized merchants, traders over a long period. And if we go back to the Sumerian civilization, we find that the Sumerian civilization was basically a federation of city-states in what is now, is what's called Mesopotamia, which means between the two rivers, Tigris and the Euphrates, which is in what is now Iraq. And we find that this area, like all the origins of the great cities of the ancient world, was based on a pre-existing trade route. There was trade, it was a center for trade before there was a city there. And this is true of every ancient city of any importance. So, you know, Sumerian trade, by the way, was very widely dispersed. If they find in Sumerian ruins or excavations, they find goods from as far away as Africa, Europe, India. The trade routes were very far-flung. So this really goes against Graeber's argument. And it's rather surprising that in one place in his book, he says that Sumer was the first state. The remarkable claim. Well, it was certainly the first state that left us a written record, because it was the first literate civilization. It was the first, Sumer was the first civilization where things were written down. There's a vast literature from Sumer, although most of it's about cost accounting, as it turns out. But there's also religious material, mythological material, political material, all kinds of literature from Sumer. But it wasn't the first state. At least one would guess not. In 1972, I could mention various precursors of Sumer, but in 1972, this is one of the most spectacular. In Varna, V-A-R-N-A, in what is now Bulgaria, they found a huge necropolis, that in other words a cemetery, 300 graves, filled with all kinds of valuables. They found a huge amount of gold in some of these graves. This Varna civilization predated the rise of Sumer. It goes back to before 4,500 BC, so before 6,500 years ago. They found lots of gold. They found lots of spondyluses, or spondyluses, I prefer to say spondyluses, but some people say spondyluses, which are the shells of spiny oysters. These are bivalve mollusks which live in warm salt water. All over the world, wherever there's warm salt water, you get spondyluses. They're quite decorative, they're quite durable, they can be worked. Most archaeologists who've looked at the site in Varna think that the spondyluses were used as currency, that they were money. They were certainly traded. And remember, they came from several hundred miles away. They came from the Aegean, which is the bit of the Mediterranean that pops up between Turkey and Greece. So these spondyluses were transported over land, and they found their way from the Varna civilization as far away as what is now Poland, Germany, and France. So we have here evidence of, first of all, it looks as though, from various evidences in these graves, it looks as though Varna was a state, and it had a strongly hierarchical society with some people who were very rich and very powerful, and had lots of gold in their graves, and other people who were more humble. But certainly, it was the centre of metalworking, salt mining, export and import over a very wide area of thousands of miles. So again, this is not mentioned. This kind of thing is just not mentioned by David Graeber. He gives you the impression that human existence begins with Sumer, where the government suddenly had the bright idea of inventing money. And this, I suggest, is not true. Prior to Varna, there was trade in Neolithic times. There was trade in stone axes. You know, we tend to think, if we haven't thought about it much, that when we hear about cavemen using stone axes, that everybody made their own stone axes. Actually, it was a highly specialized profession, because not everybody lives near a flint mine. And people who did live near a flint mine would make it a specialized profession to make these stone axes. This is over thousands and thousands of years of human prehistory. And they would trade these for all kinds of goods, again, across a wide area. One of the things that I like is that we also find very, very early on, obsidian was traded. Obsidian is a black glass that is produced in volcanoes, and it's very sharp. In fact, until, just to show you how sharp it is, obsidian until 30 years ago was used for all delicate surgical operations like removing cataracts. And then 30 years ago, they invented laser surgery. But obsidian is much sharper than any metal could possibly be. You might say it has the edge on these other cutting instruments. So obsidian was highly valued by human beings before metalworking. It was valued as a maker of knives and other tools. And it was traded over a very wide area, and obsidian has the advantage, from an archaeological point of view, that you can tell by trace elements in it exactly where it came from. So if you find obsidian in Palestine, that was actually mined in Western Turkey, you know that it had to have been transported somehow, what was in those days a very long distance and over rugged terrain. And in fact, obsidian was traded while the Ice Age was still going on. It was at the end of the glaciation, there was this obsidian trade. Now, I think that Graeber's account of money and how it developed is all wrong. I think that the traditional economist view, which was first clearly explained by Karl Menger in the late 19th century, I think is correct, and that is that money developed as a means of exchange. Now, how is that possible if we don't see barter economies? Well, I think that it happens very quickly. I think it doesn't take a very high IQ to see that it's advantageous to use one of the goods that you're trading as the thing to get hold of if you want any of the others. This happens very quickly. It's almost instantaneous. So explaining why money is convenient is a bit like explaining why syntax and grammar are convenient if you're using words. It doesn't mean there was a long period where people used isolated words without syntax and grammar. Obviously there wasn't. They were instantaneously developed together. And it's the same with money developing out of trade. One of the things that Graeber says is that the modern concept of money, which you find in Adam Smith puts forward a theory of how money evolved out of barter, but as I've said, I think this is just a way of explaining the advantages of money. Graeber confuses, in my opinion, the difference between money as a real entity and money as having a theory of money to explain it. I think many things happen in human life which go on for thousands of years, and people don't theorize much about them. They don't analyze them. Graeber says, for example, that Adam Smith invented economics in 1776 with the Wealth of Nations. And if the market phenomena he's talking about really existed for thousands of years earlier, someone would have done that earlier. Someone would have invented economics in ancient times. Well, I think this is a mistaken line of argument. In ancient Rome, military activity was extremely important to the society, but nobody wrote theoretical treatises on military strategy in ancient Rome. Or if they did, they've been lost and haven't come down to us. The closest you get would be the memoirs of generals like Caesar, who said what they did. And basically in the Roman period, and to a lesser extent in the Greek period, people didn't think of having a body of theory that you would then apply systematically to solving problems in the world. This is a later development. It was much more trial and error, partly because at least 90% of people in the Roman world couldn't read. And it wouldn't have been much use to them if they could, because a book of any kind had to be produced by hand by a scribe and would be more expensive to a typical family in the Roman world than a car would be to a typical family in our world. So they wouldn't have an abundance of reading material anyway. So in that environment of the Roman world, the whole idea of developing theories about everything, which today we do, and universities are full of people theorizing about everything, didn't exist. So it's not at all surprising that economics, as you find it in The Wealth of Nations by Adam Smith, 1776, wasn't discovered thousands of years earlier. It's what you would expect. And there are many other, Adam Smith wrote The Wealth of Nations in 1776. A few years earlier, in 1767, he wrote a book about a treatise on the origin of language. Well, nobody had done that before either, or nobody had done that very much before. So nobody in the Roman world thought of writing a book of comparative linguistics. They must have constantly been dealing with people who spoke different languages. And they must have constantly noticed that some of these languages were more similar to each other than others. But nobody actually thought, no Roman thought it worth his while to sit down and write a book saying, isn't it interesting? The Germans have all kinds of words that are a bit like Latin words, and so do the Greeks. But the Jews don't. On the other hand, the Jews have a lot of words that are like Phoenician words, or like Aramaic words. Isn't that strange? I wonder, could it be that some of these languages were once the same languages, and then they gradually diverged over a long period of people living separately? No Roman ever thought like that, or Greek. By 18th century England, that was a very natural way to think, and lots of people wrote treatises about, beginning with Adam Smith, about how language was invented, how it evolved. So the fact that nobody wrote about economics before Adam Smith doesn't prove there was no market economy before Adam Smith, which is what Graeber says. Now, in fact, it's not absolutely true. There were no economic writings before Adam Smith. I just checked this morning, because I knew I was going to say this, my copy of Schumpeter's History of Economic Analysis, which Graeber ought to have read before he wrote Debt in the First 5,000 Years. And I noticed that it's a book of 1,200 pages, and 130 pages are devoted to economic thinking from the ancient Greeks to Adam Smith. Now, it's true that it's pretty rudimentary, and a lot of the time Schumpeter says, well, this is a bit disappointing because it doesn't go much beyond common sense observation. But still, there was some economic theorizing of a very rudimentary nature before Adam Smith. so what do we come down to here? Well, it's true that there is no barter economy, but the story of the barter economy is just to bring out certain facts about the advantages of money. It's true that money did emerge spontaneously in non-state societies. Money is not an invention of the government. But I think that it's also fair to say that even if Graeber was right about the state inventing money, that still leaves open one of the major questions. Let's imagine that Graeber's right and that the Sumerian state one day had the bright idea of inventing money. And as I said, one of the problems they would have would be how to price everything instantaneously in different prices in terms of this money. But let's suppose that's how it happened. There's still the question, once they'd invented money in order to get people to pay taxes and foisted this money onto people, did people then use money just as the state intended? Or did they improvise unexpected ways of using this money that the state hadn't anticipated? And I think there's abundant evidence, of course, that money is an area of human activity that's very spontaneous and that governments find it very hard to control. One of the obvious examples of this would be Gresham's Law. Has everybody here heard of Gresham's Law?
No.
Not everybody here has heard of Gresham's Law? Oh dear. Well, Gresham, not sure what century this would be, 15th century, 16th century maybe. Gresham was a guy who first put forward this law. And the law he formulated in the words, bad money drives out good. Short for bad money drives out good money. And what did he mean by this? Well, let's suppose you have a king of England who he's got hold of the silver mines and he has a monopoly. The state's got a monopoly on issuing silver coins, minting silver coins. So they stamp the coins with the king's head to make you understand that you have to be grateful to the king that you've got some money. So this system is in place. Now, the kings of England sometimes wanted to do things that cost a lot of money, like go to war. And in order to get the money to do this, they had to ask Parliament if they could raise taxes. And Parliament would say, why do you want the taxes? And the king would say, do I want to go to war with France, or whatever it was. And the Parliament would say, well, we don't want to go to war with France, so you're out of luck. So, one of the things that the King of England might do, one of his advisors might come up with a bright idea, say, well, lead is a lot cheaper than silver. So why don't we make some of these coins with 50% lead and 50% silver? And then we'll be able to buy just as much with them as we could with the pure silver coins. And then we can buy some ships, and we can buy some men, and we can buy some swords, and we can go to war with France. So they do this. And then what happens? Mysteriously and unexpectedly, what happens is the pure silver coins disappear from circulation. That's Gresham's Law. Bad money drives out good. Or more accurately, money that's overvalued by the state drives out money that's undervalued by the state. Or even more accurately, since money doesn't do anything, only individual humans do anything, people behave in such a way that money undervalued by the state supplants money overvalued by the state because the latter disappears from circulation. And that's Gresham's Law. Now, what this tells you is that there are spontaneous forces at work in the marketplace that the government can't control. No government can control. The government can tell you that these coins are just as good as those coins, but it doesn't mean that you're going to believe them. So why is it, I mean, we can come right down to it, why is it that these pure silver coins disappear from circulation? Well, it's because silver has a price. People use silver to make candlesticks and knives and forks, although they probably didn't use knives and forks at that point, but all kinds of ornaments, all kinds of things were made of silver. So there is a market in silver, and it has a price. So if you can buy a certain amount of silver with a certain amount of lead coins, or 50% lead coins, what's going to occur to some people, who are a little bit quicker on the uptake than others, is that they can get the silver coins, melt them down if necessary to disguise what they're doing, and then go along to the silversmith and say, here's a lot of silver, and the silversmith will give them the 50% lead, 50% silver coins to a value far in excess of the silver they've handed over. So this is why Gresham's law works. So and what this tells us is that things are going on in the marketplace which the government can't control, and that even if it was true that the government invented money and then pushed it onto people, money has a life of its own, so to speak, and it can't be controlled by the government. So these are my reasons for thinking that Graeber's account in Debt, the First 5,000 Years, is false. There is something else I would say about that book. And as I say, I recommend it. It's highly entertaining. You ought to read it. And that is, I said it was an excellent pamphlet, but it has one big flaw as a pamphlet. And that is, what does he want us to believe about debt? The entire book is permeated by the notion that there's something evil about debt. But exactly what it is difficult to say. For example, most of the time, he seems to assume that creditors exploit and oppress debtors. But when he comes onto certain areas, like the Chinese holding so much of the US national debt, it reverses it. So suddenly it's, because he's a very politically correct person, and we wouldn't want to think that Chinese were doing something wicked when he could say that the US was doing something wicked. So in the case of the US government getting into debt and having creditors in China, suddenly it gets reversed. It's the US government that is being wicked by getting into debt. There's something incoherent here about what Graeber really thinks about debt. And then if you go back to his picture of village society, where everybody's in debt to everybody else all the time, and he seems to think that's wonderful. But then when it emerges onto a more cosmopolitan market society, and some people specialize in being creditors, suddenly it becomes horrible. Now, there are various, although his argument's very clear, and he's a very he expresses himself very clearly, he does make statements from time to time which are a bit mysterious. One of the things he says is that money is always an IOU. That's a very strange thing to say. If you just think about, say, Victorian England, where gold sovereigns changed hands, and there were some banknotes, not a lot, but there were some banknotes which were IOUs for gold sovereigns. And that means if you had these banknotes, you could take them, bills, as Americans would say, you can take them along to the Bank of England and they'd give you gold sovereigns. Or if you took a huge quantity, they'd give you gold bullion. but obviously, the paper notes were an IOU for the gold. But gold was money. But according to Graeber, all money is an IOU, so the gold was an IOU. Well, that doesn't make any sense. And Graeber makes statements that have a paradoxical quality. Like that. And when you look at them closely, you see that they don't make any sense. So basically, we don't really know what Graeber's take-home message on debt is. things he says is that debts cannot possibly be repaid, and that the whole system of capitalism, he doesn't like capitalism, the whole system of capitalism depends upon debts never being repaid. Now, this is a very strange thing to say. Again, it has a paradoxical quality, and you might think it, because it's paradoxical, it must be true. But actually, what would go wrong if people suddenly started paying their debts? Would the system collapse? I don't think so. Let me put it to you this way, in a more graphic illustration. Let's suppose that you're walking by a 7-Eleven, and you suddenly have the impulse, and you go in and you blow a couple of bucks on a Mega Millions. And lo and behold, a few days later you find you've won $100 million, because they haven't paid out for a couple of weeks. So let's say the IRS lets you keep $60 million of that. Now, they take the other $40 million and use it for wind turbines so that they can destroy the bodies of bats and birds and otherwise make a difference to the, without ever producing any electricity, of course. But anyway, that's the sort of thing governments do with the money they filch from you. But so you've got this $60 million, a few days later, you go to your mailbox because you've only had this $60 million for a few days, so you haven't yet hired a lot of servants to do things like open your mailbox and bring you your mail. So you go to your mailbox, you find this strange envelope, you open it up, and lo and behold, you find that it's a letter, and it is signed by four people. It's signed by Bill Gates, Georgi Soros, Kim Kardashian, and Tom Cruise. And it says, welcome to the 1%. Congratulations, you are now a fully accredited member of the ruling class. And we'd like to invite you to a meeting next Wednesday. You don't have to come in person. We have the technology to teleconference you in from whatever beach you're lying on. And this is a very important meeting because we're going to decide at that meeting on all the instructions we're going to give to the governments of the world, including the US White House, Congress, and the Supreme Court, for everything they have to do for the next 6 months. This is David Graeber's view of the world, see. My point is this. You're now a member of the 1%, and therefore a member of the ruling class. In fact, you're a member of the 0.1%. So you're a member of the upper echelons of the ruling class, and you now get to decide on government policy all over the world. You go along to a meeting, and somebody says at this meeting, well, of course, we want to increase the amount of debt in the world. And you say, hang on a bit, what? Why do we want to do that? What's in that for me? Now, let's suppose that you don't have any strong ideological inclinations, that your only inclinations is to hold on to your $60 million and make it grow as much as possible. Let's just suppose that's your... So, someone explain to me why we want to increase the amount of debt in the world? Well, I put it to you that no one would be able to offer you a serious argument as to why this would be a good thing. If everybody got a little less inclined to get into debt, if the US government trimmed down its expenditure and therefore didn't borrow so much from China, if we all trimmed down a bit of our expenditure and therefore didn't run such huge credit card, well, one thing that would happen is that credit card rates would fall, of course. But it wouldn't be a threat to the survival of capitalism. So this whole idea that debts can never be repaid is just rhetoric. It's just empty nonsense that Graeber comes out with. And it doesn't really bear examination. So that's what I think about debt the first 5,000 years. I think it's brilliantly written, entertaining reading, worth reading, recommended reading, but the basic propositions are false and can be shown to be false. Now, I want to say a little bit about other things that Graeber has written and that relate to social revolution. He wants a revolution. And he goes on various demonstrations. There were the Occupy Wall Street demonstrations. He was very prominent. He's been on all kinds of other demonstrations. Many of these demonstrations have involved violence, although Graeber says it's only the police attacking the demonstrators that causes the violence. We don't need to go into that. We do need to go into the whole rationale of going out and occupying public places and seeking confrontations with the police instead of just writing persuasive books like the first 5,000 years in the hope of changing people's minds. Seems to me that if you want a social revolution, then and you want to bring this about, the natural assumption would be that you would describe the kind of society you'd like to see, how it differs, explain how it differs from the present kind of society, and explain the steps that ought to be taken to get from here to there. In my simple-minded way, that's the way I would tend to see it. But this is not the way that Graeber sees it.
Thank you, Robert. I appreciate it.
Okay, so let's look at some of Graeber's ideas about revolution. He thinks that capitalism has not much longer to live. And this is fascinating to me because I spend a lot of my time, since I'm writing a book about George Orwell, reading what leftists in the 1930s said, socialists in the 1930s. And one thing they were all convinced was that capitalism couldn't last much longer. Capitalism was in its death throes, according to socialist intellectuals in the 1930s. And Graeber thinks it's in its death throes now. one reason, I'm just quoting here from one of his pamphlets. This is David Graeber. There is good reason to believe that in a generational so, capitalism will no longer exist, for the simple reason that, as many have pointed out, it's impossible to maintain an engine of growth forever on a finite planet. End quote. Well, that's an example of what I call the fallacy of sheer bulk, that he thinks that economic growth involves adding bulky things. Now, if economic growth did involve adding bulky things to the surface of the Earth, it's not clear that that would be so impossible, because after all, scientists tell us that tons of cosmic dust lands on the Earth every hour. So the Earth is growing in mass by several tons every hour with just this cosmic dust landing. Yeah. So more doesn't necessarily doom us, unless you think that the cosmic dust has already doomed us. What that misses is that economic growth can take the form of making things smaller, or even making them disappear. Here's my phone. It's a lot smaller than a telephone 100 years ago. It's even smaller than a telephone plus a record player plus a computer plus a camera plus I don't know what. In other words, economic growth can just as easily take the form of making things smaller and making them bigger. So the fact that the planet is finite, which it certainly is, is neither here nor there, because what economic growth means is not adding bulk, it means adding value, and that means rearranging little bits of things on the surface of the Earth, or near the surface of the Earth, so that they're better adapted to satisfy people's wants. That's what economic growth is. You know, you can get a Ferrari sports car, and it might be 50 times the price of a Ford pickup, but the Ford pickup will be heavier. It's got more mass than the Ferrari, but it has a lot less economic value. So economic growth is not going to burst the finite planet. So economic growth go on forever? Can we keep on getting richer and richer and richer? Yes, in principle we can. there is one serious problem, and that is the renewed glaciation, which is going to happen at some point in the next few thousand years, where we go back into an ice age. we can hope that by the time that happens, it could happen tomorrow, or it might not happen for another 5,000 years, who knows. we can hope that when that happens, we'll be able to somehow reduce the world's population by 98%, and everybody else will live close to the equator, and we can still have economic growth. ahead for those people. and live through the Ice Age and then come out the other end and expand again. And if this goes on long enough for a few million years, then eventually we can melt all the ice caps and the glaciers and have paradise and support an even huger population than we have now, still at ever increasing per capita economic growth or income. So this is all possible, and Graeber doesn't really give a reason for thinking that capitalism, that's a trivial, easily exploded reason. Graeber doesn't really have a good argument for why capitalism can't continue. Capitalism continued for centuries, or thousands of years. I personally believe that the free market will last for thousands of years, but we may evolve out of capitalism in a couple of hundred years. That's another matter. one of the arguments that Graeber puts forward is that his movement, which he likes to refer to as his anarchist movement, which he likes to refer to as the global justice movement, keeps on being successful. One of the examples he gives is the anti-nuclear power movement and the way that did discourage the use of nuclear power. Of course, they've got a lot to answer for. They discouraged the use of nuclear power and thus increased the use of fossil fuels. And now they're complaining about that. So some people are never satisfied. But anyway, he does think that that street protests against nuclear power are effective. And I think the obvious point to make there is that whenever you have street protests that catch the headlines, and then public policy follows what the street protests were demanding, this is because the street protests were allied with broader forces of opinion in the society. So there were lots of, you know, the articulate middle class was anti-nuke. The 1% or less of the articulate middle class that took to the streets didn't swing the public policy. It was this broader swath of opinion. So he does put forward arguments for the great success of the street protests. I'm not convinced of all of them. And one argument he makes is that whenever you have a few years without much trouble, the government goes to war, and that's because they're afraid of the street protesters. That's the reason that we invaded Iraq, for example. I'm not convinced that's the only reason we invaded Iraq. Graeber is one symptom of this general shift in the left. In the 1930s, the left were, and more recently, the left was in favor of more economic growth, more technology. Today, the left is very much opposed to more economic growth and to more technology. This is a big sea change that's happened in left-wing thinking. Since Graeber repeatedly tells us that modern capitalism is fragile, and this is one of the things about Graeber you can't help but notice, is he'll talk about something that happens, like the slump of 2008, and he'll talk as though, well, this just shows how fragile capitalism is. I don't see any evidence that modern capitalism is particularly fragile. Now, I'm a free market person. I wish there was a lot less government involvement. But if we just take what's called market democracy or modern capitalism as it is, regardless of whether we like it, the sort of system of society that prevails in nearly all of Europe and in the United States and in various other parts of the world, I mean most of the world, where you have a democratic political system, representative democracy, where you have a lot of government intervention, but still the free market can operate to some extent. You have some kind of parliament that people vote representatives to, and you have elections periodically. And you have some kind of welfare system run by the government. I would like to see it abolished, but like, we're just looking at the way it actually is. This system, call it what you like, modern welfare state capitalism, regulated free market whatever you want to call it, just look at this system and forget what you think about it, and ask yourself in terms of whether you think it's good or bad, and just ask yourself, is it a robust creature? Does it look as though it's fighting for its life, or does it look as though it's really healthy and aggressive and ready to thrive? I think that quite objectively, without any judgment about what you make of the system, it's tremendously robust.
Careful.
As we look at the world today, we see the last few outposts of a different kind of society, like in North Korea. And we know that in a few years that's going to disappear and it's going to become just like Germany and France and Britain and the US. We know that.
How?
We're absolutely confident. If we read the newspapers and look at what's going on. Why is this system of society so powerful, so robust? I think it's because there are many reasons. But one of the reasons is because if you have political democracy, then small minorities who feel very strongly about things become exposed for being small, isolated minorities. We know how many people took to the streets in the Occupy movement. They said, we are the 99%. Actually, they were the 0.001% of the people who ever think of taking to the streets, right? So we know how few they are and unrepresentative their opinions are. Now, it's true that they had some popularity because a lot of people didn't like the bailouts, but that's different, you see. That's the people like me who didn't like the bailouts. But that doesn't mean that we support the end of capitalism. It means we want capitalism without bailouts. So I don't see that... that quite objectively you can deny that modern capitalism, modern democratic capitalism, is a very robust creature, this great leviathan. It's very powerful. It's got staying power. Everything else is crumbling, and it's taking over the entire world, and it's difficult to see what could possibly challenge it. Now, Graeber has a certain view of revolution. He's a revolutionary. He wants to see a revolution that overthrows capitalism. But let's think about this. What does this mean? In the Communist Manifesto, 1848, Marx and Engels put forward their idea of a revolution. And their idea of a revolution was this, that the wage workers are going to become the great majority of the population, and they're all going to become convinced communists. And they're going to take over the governments, and they're going to bring an end to capitalism, and the first step in bringing an end to capitalism is to nationalize all of industry, so that it's owned by the state. And since they will be the great majority, the state will be the people. And they will then run industry without private property, without capitalists. So here you have the prediction of a political event.
I think you can handle
this. The
workers
take over the state. And the prediction of the kind of society that will come later,
out of here.
Which is a society without money, a society where there is no competition, a society without markets, a society where there is a single great plan, as Engels said, a single vast plan governs industry. Now, what's interesting about this is that in that document, Communist Manifesto, which is the sort of parameters of the way the left still thinks about revolution, you have a political event which is bound to happen. However, Marx and Engels had very reasoned arguments to say why this had to happen. And Marx wrote Capital, a huge book, in order to show that this was bound to happen. And it showed that the workers were bound to get worse off, that all other classes, like peasants and domestic servants, were going to disappear and all become proletarians. You were going to have a few rich capitalists owning everything, and then the great majority of the population would own nothing. On the other hand, this great majority of the population would be drilled and educated so that they could grow capitalism for the benefit of the few. the magnates of capital. And there would be a struggle, titanic struggle, between these two groups, but really there's no contest because it's 90% against 10% or 95% against 5%. And so the workers obviously are bound to win. Now, what went wrong, of course, was that nothing after the death of Marx in 1883 turned out the way Marx expected. Nothing. The workers got richer, not poorer. They got more divided among themselves, not more united. The rate of profit didn't fall. Financial crises continued from time to time, but there's no sign that they got steadily worse. So everything Marx expected didn't happen. And above all, the workers didn't become convinced communists. The workers, all at all times and places, support capitalism because that's what provides them with their wages. They sort of joined trade unions, some of them. They wanted more wages. But if you want more wages, you don't want to end capitalism. You want more wages. So nothing turned out the way they expected. So that from then on, once it was clear, which was clear by the 1890s, really, with Edward Bernstein, it was clear that things weren't turning out this way. Now you enter on a different phase. Basically, if you're realistic, you know that the great mass of the people are never going to be revolutionary. But you feel, you as a petty bourgeois intellectual, feel that there has to be a revolution, right? So you're a revolutionary, but you know that the great mass of the people are never going to be revolutionary. So you want to bring a revolution about. Well, how do you do that? Well, Lenin did it. He organized a coup d'etat in the Russian Empire, or Trotsky organized it for him, and they took over. So that's one way of looking at a revolution. But that presupposes a ruthless, disciplined group who will seize power and then suppress all dissent. If there hadn't been that, there would have been no Bolshevik transformation. There would have just been the Democratic Republic of Russia would have evolved along capitalist lines, and would have had a much more rapid rate of economic growth, and would be much wealthier today. But that didn't happen because of Bolshevism. But so this whole idea of a revolution, going back to the French Revolution, that you have this small, disciplined, ruthless group that will seize power and then implement changes. Now, if you look at the sweep of human history, you see that, generally speaking, that's not the way to bring about change. Change occurs gradually, and it happens by consent. And capitalism is a system which encourages and allows for maximum change. Change is going on all the time. I mean, change in marriage, change in attitudes to look at the rise of the teenage market. You know, going back to the 30s, teenagers had no money to spend, and hit pop records were all people in the 30s, 40s, and 50s were buying that stuff, not teenagers. Then in the 50s, you get teenagers. Something new under the sun. And it's a change. And we could go on. Religion dies. Wherever capitalism thrives, religion dies. People stop going to church. They become atheists. But even if they don't do that, they stop having any involvement with religion. That's a change. Changes are happening, quite sweeping changes. Revolutionary changes are happening in society all the time. Because they're permitted. They're not happening because a little group of people seizes state power and then says, everything's going to change. In fact, when you look at what happens, usually they don't make much difference. Look at the French Revolution. At an early stage in the French Revolution, the aristocracy voluntarily gave up all their aristocratic privileges. At an early stage in the French Revolution. So after the fall of Napoleon, when it was all reinstated, not much changed. The French Revolution was unnecessary to modernize France. And generally speaking, seizing power, the little group seizing power, now, doesn't accomplish much. Now, where it does accomplish something, like in the case of the Bolsheviks, it holds things back, and it has to suppress everybody. Now, of course, David Graeber doesn't believe in seizing power and suppressing everybody. But then neither did the syndicalists. in the 1910s and 1920s, and that's the group to which the Occupy movement is most similar. What happened to the syndicalists was that some of them formed the fascist movement in Italy, and some of them joined up with the Bolsheviks, and a few of them hung on as a little rump that didn't do much. And presumably that's what's going to happen to the Occupy movement, the global justice movement. Some of them will support ruthless, disciplined groups that will seize power, and the ones that don't will cease to have any significance whatsoever. So this leftist idea of what makes for social revolution is based on the hollow fragment of the Marxist idea. And we can see that doesn't work. So people are making signs, making gestures to me that I should stop. I can always take it.
You should have stopped a lot.
I'll wrap it up there.
Okay. Let's thank our speaker.
Distortions.
What he said, Charlie, was absolutely true.
500
All right.
I got it.
Charles, did you learn something?
Nothing.
Okay.
Nothing.
Seeing Don Ritchie is quick with his hand up there. Yep. Don?
All right. All right. One question that I have is, you said something that doesn't really, don't really understand. You said, in a village society, everybody's in debt to everybody all the time. You believe that to be true? And if so, first of all, what does that mean? And do you believe that to be true? And if so, why?
No, I was skipping over something very quickly. It wasn't what I believed, it's what Graeber believes about traditional European society. What Graeber says is this. Graeber says that in English and Scottish villages, up until the 18th century, most ordinary people had no knowledge of the market economy as we understand it. Although they were familiar with the use of money, most of what they did was on credit. So they would go to the local alehouse and then put it on the tab, and then at some future date they'd do a favor for the pub, the owner of the pub, right? Or if they wanted bread, the baker would send it to them, and eventually they'd do a favor for the baker. So that's his sort of, I'm simplifying it, but that's his picture of rural, which is the great majority, England and Scotland up until the 18th century. And he actually argues that when Adam Smith wrote, it's not from the benevolence of the butcher, the baker, etc., and the brewer, and he's a Scot after all, that we expect to get what we want. It's by addressing ourselves to their self-interest, by offering them money. What Graeber says is that was false when Adam Smith said it, because the butcher, the baker, and the brewer were actually extending credit to everybody. So that was my point. My point is that's not an accurate picture of English rural society, even in the 17th, 16th, 15th
century. You're saying that they weren't operating predominantly on credit. Well, you can make it up to later kind of thing.
Look, the baker had to buy flour from somewhere. And he had to operate the mill. He had to pay his workers, right? And he had to pay for things. It may have been true, and no doubt it was, that there was a lot more credit to consumers on, because there weren't credit cards. There was a lot more credit by shopkeepers and producers to their customers than there would be later. I don't dispute that that's true. But it's still always with an eye to what must eventually pay. I mean, bakers in 18th century Scotland kept accounts. And they knew when they were operating a loss and when they were operating a profit. And they knew when somebody was running up too much on the tab, and they'd better say, hey, I want some money or something from you, or you don't get any more bread. So, yes, credit existed. But Graeber glorifies this as a period where it wasn't really a market economy. And I think it was really a market economy, but with a market economy where there was a lot more casual credit from one from sellers to buyers.
Uh-huh. Okay.
All right. Let's see. Mike?
I just wanted to ask, I didn't think maybe it was said at the beginning, but are you a college professor? And if so, where do you teach or where do you lecture?
No, I'm not a college professor. No, I work for a publishing company.
Oh.
But I'm also a writer. I've written a few books. My most recent book was Atheism Explained.
Yes.
go ahead.
Parker?
What would he say about the Nordic countries? I read an article or part of an article in the Christian Science Monitor that said the Nordic countries, five Nordic countries, are capitalistic, but they've got heavy welfare spending, and they seem to be successful. What would he say about that?
I think that he would accept, as you and I do, that they are they're basically a modified form of capitalism. Well, a modern welfare state, and you could say the same about Germany, France, Britain, the U.S. These are essentially capitalist systems, and I don't think he would say there was any, and I don't think there's anything unique about the Nordic countries. They fit within the center of a range of modern democratic capitalist nations, and there's nothing really all that strikingly different about them. It is interesting, quite off this point, and I'll just throw this in, nothing to do with what Graeber says or anything. It is interesting that 50 years ago, we would tend to assume that the United States was more free market than most countries in the world. And today, that's definitely not true. Many Western European countries are much more free market than the United States, have much less government intervention. And in most respects, that's true of Denmark. Much less government intervention than the U.S.
You know, it's been said that one of the main reasons that capitalism succeeds in the West and isn't so good everywhere else is because of the availability of credit and the monetization that an asset can be bought or sold in this thing. Could you comment on that, please?
Yeah, well, first of all, I think it's a mistake to say it's only in the West. I mean, I think that capitalism is now thriving in China. Capitalism has been thriving for quite some time in Japan and South Korea. Singapore is another example. So I think that wherever the basic presuppositions of capitalism are installed, capitalism is successful. I don't think there's... It used to be said, that certain cultures in the world won't take it. Well, they will. And there are no exceptions. How much of it is... I mean, I think that credit is a part of capitalism. I think that it can be abused, like anything else. Some people can be too much in debt on one of them. It can be unfortunate sometimes. But by the way, make an obvious point. I said that when you read Graeber, you're not quite sure what he thinks about debt. He seems to think it's evil, but you're not sure why, and you're not always sure that he thinks it's evil. but generally speaking, I don't know if Graeber's ever said anything like this, but people who support Occupy and similar left-wing or anarchist movements usually demand the cancellation of debt to third world countries, or other forms of debt nullification. Now, I don't have very strong views about that, but I would point out that if you cancel a debt, you make it harder for future borrowers. Mm-hmm. This is obvious. Right. If the government said to credit card companies, you have to be more forgiving to people who default, what's the immediate effect is we're all going to pay more for our credit cards, right? So you can't have it both ways, right? If credit continues and you suddenly do something, or gradually do something for that matter, that benefits the debtors at the expense of the creditors, you're going to hurt future debtors, future borrowers. So you can cancel debt to third world countries, but when those same third world countries come back saying we want to borrow some money to do something useful, like build roads or something, you have to say, well, no, because you defaulted the last time.
Gene Anderson. You call those people that was demonstrating against Wall Street left wing. Now, those people, and they got the president on the side, all other high ranking people, and a few people in Congress in the city, in the Senate, and they got me.
Dessert?
These assholes, don't get me wrong, 90%, I would guess, just off the top of my head, just some observation. It's legal what they ass did on Wall Street. But the other 10% is illegal. Fraud, deception, and all of that is getting in all written anywhere in our country. And when these people get out and visibly and verbally make a stand, they are left wing. Give me a break, please. Would you reply on that?
Well, I didn't come up with the idea that they're left wing. Graeber writes and refers to, he defends himself as an anarchist against other members of the left. He accepts he's a member of the left. So it's not something I've invented that he's left wing. I mean, now, a lot of people didn't like the bailouts. The bailouts were done by Barack Obama, but some of the first ones were done by George W. Bush.
Absolutely.
And John McCain was more strident than anybody else in calling for bailouts at the time when he thought he just might get elected, and after it was clear he wasn't going to be elected, hadn't been elected. So the Republicans would have done bailouts just as much as the Democrats, it seems to me, or maybe more. But I'm against the bailouts, and Graeber's against the bailouts. Now, to support Occupy, there may be some people who supported Occupy just because they were against the bailouts. They might have supported the Tea Party on the right wing for exactly the same reason. They were against the bailouts. Basically the fact that Graeber is left wing is not controversial.
You kind of going off the point. The point I'm trying to make here is that the blind man can see what happened during that crisis. There are all kinds of books, and there are people saying, even, like I said, you had some senators of Congress, the president said, we got to change this, because what they did was improper. And some of it, that anybody, a blind man could see, was illegal. 5 or 10% of it was illegal. You can't use deception. You can't use a fraud in order to get your money, and that's what they did. And when somebody stand up and say, I don't like this, they left wing.
Bravo. Bravo.
When you have these systems of bailouts, doesn't that guarantee even more of it's going to be happening?
Absolutely.
Yep. You are rewarding them.
I think that's right. I mean, if you have the belief that some concerns are too big to fail, then of course people in big concerns can be a little less careful because they know they're too big to fail, and that's going to affect future conduct. And maybe there will come a time when they will be allowed to fail, but they will have still done something unnecessarily risky because of this sort of ethos that they're too big to fail. So, it encourages, it's the same idea. If you forgive debts, then you make it worse for future borrowers. And if you forgive big companies for getting in the hole, then it's going to lead to further trouble.
I'm sorry, Ted, Charlie was hiding behind the post there. Charlie?
Oh, all right. Now, David, you seem to imply that capitalism is somehow like inherently successful, and therefore it's going to go and continue.
Seems to be doing okay, doesn't it?
And it seems to me that historically they've been rather capitalist fascist Wall Street money mongers have been rather aggressive at times, including going against nations who don't embrace capitalism. At the beginning, way back, it's 1917, organized labor movement. This has not been wholeheartedly embraced. This has been forced upon a large portion of the people of the earth, has it not? By a few.
I'm not quite sure what you're saying.
You're saying that capitalism inherently is successful and good, and therefore it continues. Yet it has been aggressive to the nth degree to sustain itself.
I'm still not clear what you're saying. I mean, look, okay,
You just sat by idly and...
In 1945, the Labour government came in.
It's done everything
Let's see what you say about this. In 1945, the Labour government came in Britain, and within a few years, they had nationalised 20% of the British economy. And it was known, they were elected by a landslide, which was partly a statistical fluke, because they had less than 50% of the vote, but they were elected by a landslide in Parliament, and they were able to do that. Nobody tried to stop them, and the outlook of the Labour Party members in 1945 was that this was the first step and they were going to go on and nationalise everything. Now, in fact, what happened was that they were thrown out in 1951, the Conservative governments didn't do much denationalising, but the Labour government began to retreat from the idea of nationalising everything, partly because they saw what happened to the industries they'd nationalised. Now, I don't see there capitalism being forced on people. What I see there is a well-meaning minority of people who thought they wanted to abolish capitalism began to abolish capitalism. Nobody lifted a finger to stop them. There was no violent attack on them by the ruling class, by the 1% or anybody else. The only thing that happened was that nationalisation became a bad word amongst the working class voters in Britain. So the Labour Party thereafter had to be very careful about not being tarred with the brush of wanting to nationalise everything. There are many other similar episodes. Capitalism has had to fight its way against opposition, but I don't see that its success in the world is due to being violently forced on people. I don't see that at all.
You don't?
No. Where do you see a case where it's been violently forced on?
How many people do you think were killed in the organized labor movement in the history of the United States?
The organized labor movement in the United States never wanted to abolish capitalism, so that is beside the point anyway. You know,
people were killed in the organized labor movement beginning in, let's say, 1750 to today?
I don't know. You tell me.
Thousands?
Okay.
We don't even know how many.
All right. But then that's
so
right. What has that got to do with capitalism?
They didn't commit suicide.
But the point is they were not fighting to overthrow capitalism.
They were fighting for fair wages and fair treatment from their employers.
That's
a whole different thing.
That's part of capitalism.
Yeah.
Wage bargaining is part of capitalism.
Yes.
I'll leave it. This is ridiculous now.
Well, you know, the only group in the American labor movement who wanted to abolish capitalism were the Wobblies. And they were syndicalists, and they had some support among migratory workers for a while. They weren't all massacred. They just died away. From wounds inflicted by the capitalists.
Rob Kelly, yes. You made the point that... he doesn't really have a model or plan for how to, you know, move this into an egalitarian system or what he wants to do with it. Shouldn't the occupied people be looking at the Tea Party as an example, you know, of how to get empowered?
Well, right at this moment, it doesn't look as though either movements are terribly terribly vibrant, but and they may both be over, I don't know. But I mean, the Tea Party, the Tea Party had something in common with the Occupy movement, and that was that basically anybody who showed up had a voice. And so they couldn't say only these people are entitled to speak for the Tea Party. There was a big difference in this respect that various politicians on the make tried to identify themselves with, not mentioning no names, with the Tea Party, whereas very few, some Democratic politicians on the make said nice words about the Occupy movement, but they didn't try and identify with it. So they're not quite symmetrical. But the Tea Party went through various phases, whereas what happened was at first it was mainly libertarians, but then later there were a lot of social conservatives, many of whom were evangelical Christians, came in. And they had somewhat different objectives. But, I mean, there were certain things they wanted. They wanted to stop Obamacare. They wanted to stop gun control. They wanted to stop the bailouts. They had very definite political points that they wanted to reduce government spending and reduce the deficit. They wanted to cut down big government. They wanted to cut down intrusive surveillance by government of the citizens. So they had very definite objectives. Now, in the case of the Occupy movement, it's a bit slippery because they have this, first of all, they have this ideology of we're making it up as we go along and we don't yet know what we're going to make up. There's that. But there's also this that no one's allowed to speak for everything and we try to do everything by consensus. So it's harder to pin them down. As to exactly, what their program would be.
All right, Ted Aranda?
Did you say earlier you worked in publishing?
Yes.
What kind of position do you
have? I'm an editor for a book publishing company.
Could you tell us which one?
Yeah, it's a very small book publishing company called Open Court.
Open Court?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I have a couple other quick questions. Do you have an academic degree or in some intellectual...
I have a PhD in sociology.
Okay, very interesting. Also, your talk was interesting, but very unusual in the sense that people who speak on a personality usually are sympathetic. For instance, most biographies are admirers. Biographers are admirers of their subject. Could you give us a little bit more context? Like, you have an adversarial kind of quote unquote relationship with David Graeber. Could you tell us where that comes from? What that's about?
I feel quite sympathetic to him in some respects, and I say admiring things about the way he writes, and I'm a writer, and I like good, clear prose, and so I've got a lot of things. I've never met him, and he's never heard of me, but I've been writing about what's wrong with left-wing thinking since the late 1970s. Written a lot about different people. So, I mean, it just seems to me that here's somebody who comes forward as a theoretician and who is remarkably clear and unpretentious in what he says. It's worth analyzing what he says and criticizing it. I don't have any animus against him at all.
One quick follow-up. Could you give us any titles of any book you might have published or written on this subject of wrong-headed left-wing
thinking?
Well,
by the way, you asked me what publishing company I work for. Let's be clear, I don't speak for that publishing company.
Sure.
I'm just a prole, right? I do what they tell me. I'm not speaking for them in any sense. I wrote a book that was published in 1992. Which is now available as an e-book, called From Marx to Mises, which is about the impossibility of a communist system existing. And basically it argues that you cannot have electric light, central heating, air conditioning, things like that without markets, and without financial markets, without the stock exchange and futures markets and so on. You can't have all these things without capitalism. Only capitalism can allow you to have all these amenities of the good life. And that was where Marx went wrong and where Mises was right. So that's one example.
All right. Gary.
Yes, sir. Please tell us how free market capitalism was introduced into the South American country of Chile in September of 1973.
Well, I think that free market capitalism had a long history in Chile before that. There was all kinds of free market activity going back for hundreds of years. So I don't think it was introduced by Pinochet in that period. I think what happened was you had a Marxist government which had a fairly small minority of the votes, which started moving towards a Marxist-Leninist political system, and there was a popular uprising against that. And then the military stepped in support of that popular uprising, and put a stop to that. They weren't introducing free market capitalism. Now, what happened later was that they brought in advisors from the University of Chicago, and they introduced various free market reforms. As a result, Chile today, where at that point Chile was one of the poorest countries in Latin America, it's now one of the richest countries in Latin America because of those free market reforms that were brought in the 80s.
Was it really a popular uprising, or was it a U.S.-backed coup?
I've never seen any evidence that it was a U.S. bank coup. I mean,
were you looking? Were you looking?
Give me some evidence, and I'll accept it. I mean, look. Suppose it was a U.S. bank coup. I mean, so what?
What do you mean, so what? A coup?
Well, was the takeover of Czechoslovakia by the Communist Party a Soviet bank coup? Yeah, of course it was. But so what? I mean, what's this got to do with anything?
Well, it's okay to kill people.
Was the Cuban regime a Soviet-backed coup?
No, that was a CIA-backed coup.
Oh, the CIA put Castro in power?
Yes,
okay. I'm not in favor of using the U.S. taxpayers' money to support coups in other countries. And if there was any CIA involvement in the uprising against AND, then I think that was unfortunate. But that's really, what has that got to do with the merits of a free market system as opposed to a state-controlled system?
Why does it have to be shoved down people's throats?
You don't see this in the world as a whole. If you look at the sweep of history over the past couple of centuries, you don't see it being thrust down people's throats. What you see is that people want the good things of life, and they realize that only capitalism can give them the good things of life.
Oh, that's not thrust down anyone's
throats. You don't know the history of South America.
Only if you're rich and rich.
The bosses.
You're the boss. The next
Yeah. Hello. Can you? Maybe I missed it. If anybody asked the question in a little different tone or something, but can you give us your idea of what Americans could or should do about the billionaire predators? They're buying and selling our politicians in the Supreme Court, and they have taken total control of the U.S. government since the year 2000. What should we do about those predators that are running an unregulated capitalism system that is just destroying the middle class?
Whatever you say about present-day capitalism, you can't say it's unregulated. It's very heavily regulated. I don't see billionaires buying and selling U.S. politicians. I mean, I don't think that there are billionaires. Yogi Soros is one, and he gives money to the Washington Post and all these left-wing causes. Many, they're just as likely to be left-wing as right-wing in their views. It isn't clear to me that they get together in a cabal and decide what U.S. policy shall be. I look at the formation of U.S. policy, and I see various influences on it. And they have to do with a lot of lawyers, they have to do with a lot of think tanks in Washington, most of which are left-wing. They have a lot to do with a lot of Ivy League professors, most of whom are left-wing. I don't get this idea I don't like the political views of the Yogi Shorosh, but I wouldn't call him a predator. It seems to me that Shorosh is a currency speculator, and he's very good at it.
I was talking about people like the Koch brothers.
Yeah. And they're predators?
They're trying to get rid of all environmental regulations.
Are they predators?
Yeah.
No.
I don't see the Koch brothers as being predators.
They're like Mother Teresa.
They're very small scale compared with Shorosh. But anyway, they're not predators. Now, they like me, they're against a lot of regulation. But that's just their opinion. Like it's my opinion.
Okay. We're going to have to start getting into rebuttal soon.
Oh, no. Wait a minute. We got at least the question.
Well, it's almost 8:25, so.
Yeah.
Jim's right. We've only got an hour left.
All right.
Another questioner. We will move to our rebuttal period.
Okay.
All right.
Russell, you have a question.
On these so-called predators, isn't it true they're only predators when they're doing things that you don't agree with?
Is that the question?
No, it's got nothing to do with whether I agree with it or not. I mean, I just don't think that making money in currency speculation is being predatory. Which is what Shorosh does. I think if you're a speculator, since this has come up, I'll develop it slightly. If you're a financial speculator, if you do well at what you do and make a lot of money, you're helping society more than you're helping yourself, because you're helping to coordinate things in the direction of equilibrium, which is making things more efficient at satisfying people's wants. If you screw up and you're not successful, then you lose your money and you become, like me, a proletarian.
They're helping.
So
Black Forest.
I don't see that people who go in for financial industries, and of course that's only one type of financial industry. I don't think that traders, stockbrokers, people like that, are predators. I think they're doing a useful job.
Yeah. No,
making
I'm
a little
I'm
money
not,
too.
I was mostly aiming at. It's only the ones who are doing it that you don't agree with that are the predators. If you agree with your Soros, then they're not...
No, I disagree with Soros, but I'm saying he's not a predator. I disagree with his political opinion. There is an interesting question here, and that is that in the whole... I've made a study of left-wing movements throughout history, especially... since the sort of early 19th century. And there's a very interesting story to be told about rich people who bankrolled these left-wing movements. Engels was a capitalist who sent part of the proceeds that he got from exploiting the workers in Lancashire to Marx so that Marx would write more damning stuff about capitalism. Hyndman, H-Y-N-D-M-A-N, was the leader of the British Marxists in the early 19th century. He was a top-hatted capitalist who went to the London clubs and had pots of money. And he founded Marxism in Britain. He founded the Social Democratic Federation. There are many other examples like this where, basically, if you have any kind of ideological grouping that attracts more than a few hundred members, you're bound to catch a rich person or two who will give you money. That's fine. I'm not opposed to them giving money to these. I don't think there's something sinister here. I think it is unfair to blame people like me who are opposed to the global warming hysteria. It's unfair to blame people like me because there exist people like the Koch brothers who share our opinions and sometimes throw money in that direction. They haven't thrown any at me. And not blame the Shoroshis who are much richer than the Kochs and throw much more money at the left. But I don't think any of this is wrong. I think the rich people, if I became filthy rich, I'd probably give some money to causes I agree with, and some of them would be, anti-global warming hysteria. I think that's quite natural. And I think that rich people tend to have a full range of political opinions, including most of them being totally uninterested in politics and not wanting to get involved at all.
Okay.
Brethren and sisters, we come to the point
where... All right.
get a chance to speak at the end of our meeting, but how many here would care to enlighten him and the rest of us?
4 minutes, Brom.
Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Here. How much time do we have?
Brom, let's go with about 4 minutes with encouragement to wrap it up quickly. I've got a timer here. We're all set to go, and let's get right at it.
All right, beginning with Gene
Horcher.
All right.
And proceeding to
Gene's
the
one. Yeah. Gene, which side are you on?
Which side? Somebody give me a 1 minute warning.
I'll give you a 1 minute warning.
Okay. I am a left winger. I don't see capitalism as falling apart. I don't know if it'll ever fall apart, but I sort of don't see it falling apart in my lifetime. The speaker did not speak too much about the fact that there are left-wingers who aren't socialists. I would put myself in the socialist realm, but I'm actually in the community organizing. That came out of labor organizing, people like Saul Alinsky. So that community organizing is really not a far left wing part of our society. What's community organizing tries to do is treat people right and improve small sections that we can reach in improving whether it be housing, healthcare, this sort of thing. Give you an example. Jane Addams Senior Caucus is hiring interns this summer. We were going to pay them $10 an hour, but we realized, wait a minute, you're advocating for 15 bucks an hour and you're going to pay these kids, young people, kids, 10 bucks an hour? No. The finance committee raised that to 15 bucks an hour. So if you want, if you got somebody in college who wants a nice job for the summer, apply to Jane Addams Senior Caucus if you want to learn community organizing. So community organizing is a section that the speaker did not speak about, because I agree with him that most people are not interested in socialism. There's a few socialists in Jane Addams Senior Caucus, but frankly, we are on the periphery. I don't talk much about that. I talk about the issues that we're going to. One other thing that I will try to bring next week, if I'm here, I probably will be. There was talk about Chile. In the last, about one or two of Christian Science Monitors ago, they had they talked about, is that 1 minute?
Yeah.
They talked about social justice evaluation. And the lowest evaluation, as I recall, is Chile, where the Chicago boys helped them out. I think the top one on the list is another capitalistic group. I think it's Norway, where they have both capitalism and social welfare. Thank you. Right.
I'm working on a letter to Charles Koch about the difference between a free and a free in quotes market. And I'm going to get into a lot of things we've heard about tonight. Yeah, I should have it next week sometime. But if anybody wants me to email it to you, leave me your address tonight.
Yeah, I'm Michael Foley. Capitalism does not exist in the United States of America. The economic system we have is called bribery, armed robbery, and welfare checks. Rich people go to the United States Congress and give bribe money to the politicians that serve in the United States Congress. That's called a campaign contribution. The politicians send their gunslingers throughout the country and collect money from us. It's called taxes. The gunslingers bring the tax money back to the politicians in Washington. The politicians give billion-dollar welfare checks to the people that gave them the bribe money. One way or another, there's no such thing as capitalism, competition, or anything, except who can give the biggest bribe to the politicians and who gets the biggest handouts from the politicians.
I thought that was called the mob.
It's all modern now.
So they're changing.
Now, I've heard people talk about the United States, the society we got, or the system we have in here, whatever you want to call it. Democracy or whatever is a nice word, but it's a fairy tale. Some people call this country a police state. And I tell them you're correct about that, but I prefer to use the word military dictatorship. I believe that the system we have in this country, I believe the United States of America, is a military dictatorship. And if you disagree, just go to our airfield and try to get on an airplane. When they tell you they got to strip search you before you get on an airplane, say, hey, I got my rights, I'm not doing anything wrong, I'm acting in a legal, lawful manner. There's no reason to strip search me. And hope you get out of jail before you die. Another thing, this is on a different topic. We are now at war in Nigeria. One way or another, the United States of America is involved in war in Nigeria. And don't forget, Nigeria is an oil company.
Right.
And, excuse me, an oil country. I don't know what oil companies run it, but Nigeria is an oil country. Now, we also sent military people to Chad. I think we've already had soldiers in Chad, but if not, then we're also at war in Chad. And as far as what's going on in Thailand, we've been told there's been a military coup in Thailand. Thailand is a colony of the American Empire. So whatever happened with this military coup in Thailand, it was all done on orders of the American Empire. Okay, that's all I got. Thank you.
Okay, next.
Yeah, my name is Gene Anderson. It only take me a minute or two because I cannot comment on what he said, everything he said, because he said a lot of things that I didn't agree with. But he said things like the government doesn't control the money. The government can't control the money. Well, that's not true. Like I mentioned when I asked the question. Some of us can see and hear despite what the distractions are. Now, the government is controlled by the 1%ers. You mentioned revolution, and you mentioned a revolution in the past. Well, we even read little books about China, the Russian Revolution, even our revolution, and so forth and so on. And if we're going to be stereotyping our thinking, then we'd be thinking about people with guns and shit running around shooting one another and all that like you see in the movie. But I got news for you. We already been in an evolution, and it was taken over by the few, and they didn't fire a goddamn shot. Now, if we want our country back, if we did what they did, we could get it back without firing a shot. Now, when something happened that is in the paper, it's right on TV, people, for instance, like the Wall Street and the crew that was connected and so forth and so on, they created $15 trillion out of nothing. And like I asked the question, a lot of that was legal because they done bought the senators and everybody else and the congressmen and everybody else to pass a law that allowed them to do this and that and so forth and so on, to be able to create $15 trillion out of nothing. However, even our government done fined J.P. Morgan Chase billions of dollars for what they did in the same time. If you read the paper a few weeks ago, they got a bank for X number billion that were doing the same thing by lying to Fannie Mae and whatever you call them things up there in Washington. Billions of dollars. Now, the speaker gonna speak like he didn't ever seen that. Oh, I don't know about that. This is the way he be talking. Well, I got news for you. I've heard Lynn Ball and Jay Levine and Sean Kennedy and all these folks. He should be their twin. Now, Lynn Ball can speak with anybody out there. And what I mean about that, he can talk. And he's good. I used to listen to him. However, and he wasn't as radical as Levine and so forth and so on. He would kind of keep the story answering. But to him, two and two is five. To Jay Levine and all of them, two and two is five. To the speaker, he mentioned Orwell, two and two is five. Now, what did Orwell mean about Winston Smith and Goldberg been about two and two is five? Smith says it's four. What he meant was simple. He didn't mean that in no literal sense. He mean just what Lynn Ball, Jay Levine, and the speaker be talking. They be talking about everything but what you can see, what you know, and what other folks are saying. Thank you.
Two and two make five. Right, John. All right,
then
Robert.
Okay.
Okay.
Thanks for your talk. By the way,
it's Mark Levin.
Okay, first of all, I read a very good book. It was pretty thick, actually, and it was pretty definitive by a very good author on Chile and the U.S. involvement and the coup there. And I'm sure there have been many other books and publications written about this. So there's no question about the U.S. Role of pushing a coup in Chile, first of all. Secondly, I read a book by Graeber on anarchism. In fact, the title might have been Anarchism. I don't remember exactly. And I found it to be pretty inadequate. And I have a problem with anarchism anyway. And I think I kind of agree with some of your positions on the loose thinking among the left. I think that we have to be self-critical. I'm a leftist myself. But I think that we have to be critical about how we think. And one of the things that we have a problem with, I think, is this blanket anti-capitalist stance. I actually agree with you that capitalism as such, in general, is pretty robust in this country and in the world. And just carrying on like a lot of leftists do, anti-capitalism, capitalism bad, capitalism bad, is kind of a non-starter in this country. First of all, you have to ask yourself, what is capitalism? Is it buying and selling? Is it profit-making? Is it private property? Is it trading? Are we going to condemn all those people on all these streets as you pass by, all these small businesses? We can't just have a blanket anti-capitalism position. That's a non-starter. So my criticism of this country and this system of ours is not capitalism as such. It's the political system. It's the fact that we don't have a democracy. The rich rule, not because they have their capitalists, but because they control our quote-unquote representatives. And that's probably more or less what I have to say. We can regulate capitalism. We can limit capitalism. We can keep a lid on the rich and their ridiculous profits in all kinds of ways. We can have progressive taxation, effective taxation. We can encourage unionization. We can prohibit monopolies and oligopolies. We can put an end to the Wall Street crimes by jailing these criminals. We can do all kinds of things. We don't have to have this ridiculous, as far as I'm concerned, blanket anti-capitalism stance. Thanks.
Good evening, I'm David Travis. I'd like to begin by saying that I read Mr. Steele's book, From Marx to Mises.
Mises.
From Marx to Mises.
From Marx to Mises.
And I thought that it was an excellent book. If you'll please refrain from correcting me on every other word, I'll be very happy. I want to say that I think common sense dictates in this case, if we consider that necessity is the mother of invention, that ancient man made fire to keep warm. When man learned to control fire, he held technology in his hands. Man, from that point, could do tremendous things. From that, fire is the very root of technology. With fire, man could make skyscrapers, automobiles, even money. And speaking of money, when man made fires to keep warm with, and they found that when they put rocks in the fires, after the fire went out, the rocks stayed hot and continued to radiate warmth, and so they could stay warmer longer without having to go back and feed the fire. However, when they later brought other rocks to the fire, they found that metals ran out of the rocks from the intense heat of the fire. And from there, they got things like copper, lead, zinc, gold, and silver. Gold and silver being more rare than the lead or the copper were obviously, man deduced that they were more valuable. So the copper could be used to be fashioned into tools and rudimentary jewelry. Silver could be fashioned, and gold could be fashioned into jewelry and other things. So they each had certain properties that were valuable. But once man had these things, he could then trade them. And as it is said, gold is money, and money is gold, and to a lesser degree, silver. What's more, gold could be cut up in pieces. So barter existed prior to money, but barter still exists today. People trade things, especially in smaller towns. There's a lot of barter that goes on. However, once man had gold and he could cut gold up into pieces, he then could buy a quarter of a cow and give out a certain larger piece of gold for it and get change in several smaller pieces of gold and have his quarter of a cow. So that money made it possible to buy things without having to do exact barter, where it was even trade, but I can trade you a smaller thing for a bigger thing, or a bigger thing for a smaller thing, and we can make change. So that's about all I have to say, except that I did talk to an ancient Roman, and I asked him if it was true that no Roman ever went to China or even halfway to China, and he said he wouldn't even go a quarter of the way to China.
Oh. Mr. Ritchie.
All right.
Okay.
All right. My name's Don, and I'm a capitalist. All right. Because I happen to be the owner of a small business, Hyde Park Tutoring, and I provide tutoring services to elementary school, high school, and college students, and in most subjects covered. So yes, I am. I'm a small business owner, an entrepreneur. Now, a lot of people equate that, you know, they say that's capitalism, but. And I hear that term. I don't know what capitalism is, to tell you the truth. But I hear people say it. Capitalism is private business ownership. So I guess that means I'm a cap. That's why I say I'm a capitalist.
And then what you'll hear is they'll say, well, you know, shouldn't a person like me, for example, have a right to do business? And I say, absolutely. But I would maintain that there is a difference between a guy like me or a street vendor selling snow cones and Jamie Dimon over at J.P. Morgan Chase taking a big bailout from on behalf, from the U.S. government at the taxpayer's expense. I think there's a big difference. And I think to conflate the two is a very big error. I'd say the same thing. I think there's also a considerable difference between, you know, between a guy who let's say, runs between the owner of the Hilltop Restaurant and British Petroleum. So, and I think that our failure to recognize the difference between these two things is a lot of what's wrong in society, and a lot of what's wrong with all of our political debate. Now, I was very interested because I was very interested in the Occupy Wall Street movement. I actually went to a lot of the Occupy Wall Street actions back when they were still operating. Well, not Occupy Wall Street, but Occupy Chicago back when they were still operating here in Chicago. And even though I am not out, to abolish our, abolish all capitalism and bring in a form of government resembling that of North Korea. But I did think that there was something wrong with the bank bailout, which is why I often wear my T-shirt, "Bankers of the World Unite," because what you have going on here is a kind of socialism for the rich. It's socialism for the ruling class, and the perilous tides of the free market for the rest of us, So the rich in this country are protected by the government. The rest of us are left to fend for ourselves, whether we're just employees working for some company or whatever, or whether we're self-employed business owners. Now that's not fair, and nobody can claim that it is. Now, I was prepared to like this presentation, but I saw a lot of problems with it. One is they're just a series of factual errors, which I'll get into. First of all, on the subject of Chile, I'll just start there. Chile had a socialist president, Allende, who was elected by popular vote in what was generally conceded to be an honest election. And as Ted Aranda pointed out, he was then overthrown by a CIA-backed coup d'etat, which then brought in a kind of a radical program of privatization and deregulation. The idea that Chile wasn't a poorer country, it was actually one of the richer countries in Latin America even before that, and as it is now. And the only other thing I want to say is one of the most serious errors that we need to look at is the idea that economic growth can go on forever. As long as we're confined to one planet, it cannot, because the planet itself is finite. And this debunking of global warming, I'm going to say that the consequences of global warming are going to be catastrophic. And the people who are going around denying it are going to have blood on their hands. And,
blood on their hands.
Okay.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
That's right, Charlie.
Before we hear from our honorable organizer, I have a couple of remarks. I had a professor back at Wacker College whose name I can't remember for the life of me, but he was a Sumerian translator. He had translated Sumerian into probably German, because he was spoke German. He was a scholar and done most of his research in German documents and so on. And Wagner College was pretty German anyway. German and Lutheran. And he was a Lutheran minister. Well, anyway, sweet guy. But the text that he used in some of his religion classes was, history begins at Sumer. Well, at any rate, in Sumer. It was at that time the first, the oldest recorded civilization that we knew, and or Western scholarship knew, whatever somebody may have ancestral traditions that trace back their little village to any city that was somewhere else. Anyway, Sumer. Why is Sumer important? Well, if you're going to trace the origins of money or the state or anything that is civilized, you might want to see what happened in Sumer. And if you have theories about the origin of money and its uses and economic practices and social practices, you might want to examine what we have of Sumer, because they did write things down. And and so we can find out a lot more about Sumer than their contemporaries, even though they may have left artifacts, even golden artifacts from exchanges, whether they're bartered exchanges or whatever. All right, so our speaker dwelt a great deal on Sumer, and this pamphlet writer, Graeber. Why is Graeber important and his pamphlet important? Well, because there was a movement to occupy things. Now, it wasn't just sit-down strikes like we had in Ford and other motor industry plants in the 30s, and which stimulated the union movement even in the pits of the Depression to take over capital, that is, plants and industries, which was sort of revolutionary. And if you want to assert the rights of workers, you have to, the workers are going to have to assert them by taking over what is theirs, the means of production that they work at.
And your time is up.
Thank you, Tim. Thank you all, and our next speaker is Charlie Peta.
All right, let's thank our speaker again. Thank you, David. Spending some time, I'll be eclectic and quick here because we're running on here. My colleague here alluded to the fact that he called them historical inaccuracies. I'll use a gentler term there. 500 personal interpretations of history, let's put them that way. I wouldn't use a term like distortions, of course. That's kind of pejorative. But all right, Sumer, we've been over. That's good. And there's all kinds of stuff, the beginning of civilization, and that's as good. They find little villages here and there. I mean, I guess you could claim Atlantis was earlier or something, you know, if you wanted to, be my guest. Among the ancient community.
I mean, scholars, this is good enough. You know, the thing is, the history of money is, in fact, the history of control. Actually, in terms of, you mentioned that, first of all, let me get back a minute here, that there were no economies based on barter. And I was a docent for about 10 years on pioneer life in America here in Illinois. And that virtually was a barter economy. People may not be aware of this. They had very little, in effect, money. And parallels to it, if you go north to Canada, I've just been studying that, in terms of the trading, the Hudson's Bay activities and things like that, there virtually was no money in those economies. But personally here on the Pioneer, on the frontier, there virtually was no monetary exchanges. So I think you don't have to go looking all over the place. But capitalism is, in fact, the history of money. If you take it as the history of capitalism, it's the history of control. One guy accrues capital or wealth and subjects another. He tells another guy to do, he is able to control, it diminishes the freedom or inactivities of others for his own, ultimately it's his personal gain. And inherent in the system is that the number of people who achieve personal gain gets smaller until you end up with, in fact, 1% and 99%. In that sense, this author is entirely correct. And sooner or later, people say, you know, this system, which has gone incredibly aggressively to sustain itself. Capitalism is not accepted by any means. Anyone who says so is, again, just using historical distortions, because it's a system based on force. And what capitalism does is, you've got to be cautious that capitalism does not become aligned with government. And then you're really in trouble in situations like that. Now, what you saw was a lot of people began to identify with this and to say, you know, your sociologist, the social stratification that was taking place had achieved a level. And it certainly is not positive. The rich and the poor and the dichotomy, the figures of that are alarming. And there's only a few individuals spontaneously, however it came about, you know, this began to be realized here. And when people say, you're not going to push me around anymore, you better watch out. All right, running me over here. All right, I got to get going, but the other thing, and last thing I got to end in, I've been hanging around the green community for an awful long time. And this thing about the earth and dust, there actually is a guy who's claimed the name of the cosmic dust. It really doesn't accrue in any substantive amount. All the minerals that we have were created essentially 13.7 billion years ago. There's no new ones. And you, actually, while you were talking there, it was amazing that capitalism now is going after rare earth elements.
Yep.
And they're going to extreme ends. This is the new hot stuff of speculation and things like this. It's shameful what capitalism has done to the earth. It's got to be stopped. It should not have been allowed to have gotten the way it has. They've destroyed this planet.
Okay.
And if anything, that would be indicative that it is not a benevolent operation by any means. Let's see what else.
Okay, Charlie, it's a 5.5 minutes.
Throw me out. All right, thanks a lot, then.
Our speaker gets the last word.
Can I take that?
Okay, well, there's a lot of... nobody had much to say about what I actually said. people wanted to talk about Chile for some reason.
I don't know why. I don't think Chile is an argument against capitalism. I'll just mention that somebody said that Allende was elected in a free and open election. Well, that's perfectly true. But then each of the main, there were three main parties, they each got about a third of the vote. And they had to decide who would be president. And they gave it to Allende, who had slightly more than a third of the vote. I think the understanding was that if you come to, they needn't have done that. The other two parties could have given it to one of themselves, or they could have had a coalition against AMD, but they decided to do that. I think the understanding there is if you've just got a third of the vote and you've been given the premiership by the other two parties, that you'll adopt a moderate program. Instead, he adopted a radical Marxist-Leninist program and it aroused opposition in the country. Now, if the CIA supported the coup, then I don't think that's what the CIA should be doing. In fact, I don't know that the CIA should be doing anything. This doesn't alter the fact that the Chicago advisors who went to Chile gave some good advice. And various industries were privatized, and Chilean population today still benefits from this. Now, you know, when Milton Friedman went to Stockholm to get the Nobel Prize from the King of Sweden, there were huge demonstrations, and that was because he'd gone visited Chile as a private citizen and had some talks with government ministers. Now, at the same time that that was happening, no end of American economists were visiting Moscow, which had a gulag which had killed 20 million people. And they were giving advice to the Soviet government, and there were never any demonstrations about that. So I think that the left has a certain blinkered view of this kind of issue. But as I say, I don't defend anything the CIA did in Chile, if they did anything. And it doesn't have much to do with the question of whether capitalism is a good system. Capitalism existed in Chile under Allende and had existed for hundreds of years, and it will exist for hundreds of years more in Chile. It's doing quite a good job. Somebody said that the US is a military dictatorship. I don't think that's true. There are certain ways of, objective ways of telling. I'm not completely satisfied with the American political system. However, we can have a meeting like this where people can say all sorts of different things. We don't half expect that at 4 o'clock in the morning the police are going to break into our house and take us away and we disappear without trace because of anything we said, which might be heretical. You can go and vote, you can stand as a socialist, a communist, a Trotskyist, a Maoist, a libertarian, a teetotaler, a vegetarian, and if you get enough votes you can get elected. This doesn't look like a military dictatorship to me. It certainly is a country which has a big military force, a bigger military force than the rest of the world put together, and is not shy about bombing people, and it's something I'm against war as an instrument of US policy, and I oppose most of these, if not all of these military activities of the United States, but it doesn't mean that the United States is itself a military dictatorship. 2 + 2 = 5 was mentioned. The point of that in 1984 is that there is only one doctrine is allowed to be believed in, the official doctrine, INGSOC, of the ruling party. Every other form of thought is outlawed and you cannot preach it. You'll be taken away and tortured and killed. That's the system. And the system is based on the Soviet Union and Nazi Germany, both of which, in Orwell's mind, were totalitarian societies. And 2 + 2 = 5 is actually based on the first five-year plan, where it was a slogan of the Stalinists. It was 2 + 2 = 5, because they said, fulfilled the five-year plan in 4 years. One of the first thoughts to cross my mind would be, well, that wasn't according to plan.
but anyway, that over-fulfilling the plan is always good in that kind of system. And they bragged about this, 2 + 2 = 5. And he may have been influenced by the doctrine of the Trinity. You know, the Catholics and the Protestants tell us that one is three and three is one. And if you believe in that, you have to make a hard effort to believe it. Let me say a little bit about, to wrap up, the general. Graeber would be important as a left-wing thinker, a leading left-wing thinker, even if there was no Occupy movement. He's an anarchist, and I think part of the reason we have an outstanding left-wing thinker like David Graeber is that there's a disillusionment with state control and with socialism since the fall of the Soviet Union, and this has permeated everywhere. So Graeber is offering apparently a non-statist alternative to the traditional statist views of the left, and that's why I think he's an important figure. I think that he's made an attempt to mount a criticism of capitalism. I tried to explain why I think that's fallacious in various ways. I don't think that capitalism, apart from the question of whether we like capitalism or not, there's a question of whether it's robust, whether it's a strong system that's going to survive. And I'm just saying that objectively, to me, whether you love it or hate it, it looks like a very robust system that is going to survive. Now, Charlie said that capitalism had destroyed the earth. Well, the earth isn't destroyed. Going after rare earths is supposed to be a bad thing. I mean, rare earths are being used in telephones and things like that. I mean, they're being used for useful, productive things to make people's lives better and generally increasing output, increasing economic growth does make people's lives better. People are happier. The big difference between the left 50 to 100 years ago and the left today is that 50 to 100 years ago, the left was in favor of technology and economic growth. Now, the means they proposed for getting technology and economic growth were wrong means that wouldn't work. But they believe in technology and economic growth. Today, the left is opposed to technology and economic growth. And this is what all this global warming nonsense is about. It means stopping the industrialization of the third world so that the people in the third world will starve.
That's what it means.
If you're in favor of well-being for people all over the earth, you should reject this greenest nonsense that's coming from the left. You should reject this idea that we're going to face a catastrophe because the global temperature has gone up 1/7 of a degree in the past 150 years, and is now at a standstill and is not warming at all. You should reject the idea that catastrophe is just around the corner, because it's not. What we're facing is, as we face regularly throughout human history, we're facing a new glaciation. It may happen tomorrow, it may happen 5,000 years from now, we don't know when it's going to happen. It's going to happen, it's going to get colder. And that's the real challenge. Cold is bad, warm is good.
How do you know that?
How do I know that?
Right.
Well, I know that because in the medieval warm period, people prospered. In the Roman warm period, which was 2,000 years ago, it was even warmer than in the medieval warm period, which means it was way warmer than it is today. And we know this for a whole range of reasons, one of them being that many Roman cities that were ports then are now many miles inland because the sea level dropped so much since then. We know that warm is good for human beings, that human civilization expands and prospers and people are better off when it's warmer. And we know that when it's cold, people die. And even today, more people die in cold weather than die in hot weather. Every winter, people die because of the cold weather. Far fewer people die.
People don't die of heat
in the hot weather from the heat in the hot weather. So, this is this. And by the way,
this whole idea that warming is a threat which is going to cause catastrophe will be forgotten about in a few years' time. It's just one more silly environmentalist scare. It's like, you had acid rain, and nobody talks about acid rain anymore. Why not? Well, because they've got global warming. Ten years from now, you will be going around saying, nobody ever believed that. Nobody ever believed that global warming was going to cause catastrophe. That will go into the memory hole. Putting carbon dioxide into the atmosphere is a good thing. Of course it's a good thing. It stimulates plant growth and feeds people.
It's good for trees.
This is elementary. Part of the reason why the fewer people are starving in the third world today is because plant growth has been stimulated by more carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. It's a great thing. It hasn't caused any warming, but it has stimulated plant growth.
You ever heard of a drought?
If it's hot, it's wet. Droughts become more common in cold weather. Droughts are more common in cold weather. But look at the whole history of Africa, the colder it gets, the more droughts you have. The warmer it gets, the wetter it is. You have rainforests, because warm air carries more moisture. This is elementary, it's ridiculous to overlook these basic scientific facts and fall in for this pseudo-scientific claptrap about global warming.
How do we end up on a lot of
Does he ever finish?
Well, you're going to fight. You're
going to
fight.
Warm is good.
Warm baby burn.
Drill
is good. Drill. Cold is bad.